The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
If you are visiting us here in the sanctuary or online, welcome. We're glad you're here. Today is the last day of the World Mission Offering. Throughout October, we have rallied around the words of Isaiah, God is doing something new. God makes us new in wonderful, surprising, and sometimes challenging ways. We are called to act, to look with Jesus' eyes and see a new life as he sees. You can give to the WMO by placing your offering in the plates when they are passed later, or you can give through our website, nhcbc.com. I invite you to use the next 2 minutes to prepare yourself for worship. Let us make ready for worship.
To end our World Mission Offering promotion this month, I invite you to meditate on the words of our theme from Isaiah 43, verse 19. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. As we experience the silence of winter, which is quickly approaching, followed by the new life that buds in the spring, you are invited to remember that God speaks prophetic words for the future. He says, do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. He is leading us through dark times such as the COVID pandemic, times of violence, and the loss of our family and friends to death, but he promises to bring new life. Let us rejoice as we celebrate the hope that comes from these words. God is about to do a new thing. Please rise in body or spirit and join in singing songs of praise.
Prophet Joel writes, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. In his letters to the Romans, the Apostle Paul uses Joel's words. Paul says there is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for the Lord is the Lord of all, and anyone who calls on him will be saved. What that means for you and me is that all are invited to turn to the Lord, not just the well-off or the ones who seem to have their life together. No, Jesus wants all, the messy, the bruised, the folks who feel like they are drowning. The hymn, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee, embodies that call for us to be saved. We ask for Jesus to teach us, share our burdens, guide us, strengthen us to learn to trust again and give peace and no matter how rough the waters of life may seem. Let's sing to Jesus.
Of toil, the
Of life. Calm our fears and strengthen our faith that we may never doubt your presence among us. Remind us that you have gifted us each other. Each of us plays a part as we navigate smooth times and rocky times. You have called each of us by name to serve and worship you alone. Accept our worship this hour. May it give glory to you, the true Son of God, and all God's children say, Amen. You may be seated.
I jumped in front of you.
I know.
Good morning. We're just going to take a moment to tell our pastors, Paul and Felicia, how much we appreciate them. And as Eric shared in the call to worship, God is doing something new. And we realize it so much just in our church that we are in a whole state of newness. Pastor Paul's here helping us through that interim until we have a new pastor. Pastor Felicia's been here to support us through all of this as well. We thank them both for their preaching, their teaching, their support and care of us. And I would like to invite all of you to join us in the cafe afterwards for some punch and cookies and to take some personal time with them to share your appreciation with them. Thank you.
Let's turn our attention to the prayer concerns that have been lifted before us today. We have several, and I would like to share them with you now. Please be in prayer for Linda Wagner as she struggles with health issues. Flo Bruckman has been having difficulty this week. She's been hospitalized and is waiting to be transferred to a rehab facility. Pray for her health and her family as they care for her. Rhonda Lyon is in the hospital. Pray for Rhonda, her doctors, and her family. Please pray for Sue Clark's nephew, Dan, and his family. He's currently in a halfway house after completing rehab for alcohol abuse. Ask the Lord to help him get his life back on track. Lynn Burney's brother, Kevin, will be having surgery on Tuesday. Please pray that the doctors and the medical professionals will do all that they can to bring about the healing that he needs and for an easy recovery for him. Please pray for Karen, a friend of Pauline Spring. She's battling bone cancer as well as for her doctors and her family who are her caregivers. Remember and pray for those affected by the Tree of Life shooting, which was 4 years ago this past week. Also, we've been asked this morning, several of you have handed these to me. Cindy Benz asks us to be in prayer for her brother David. A CT scan showed a large mass on his lungs. Also pray for Cindy's cousins, Michelle and Kimberly, as they face many health challenges. Also, we are being notified that Lynn Harvey passed away this past week, and her family and her sons, Josh and Adam, and daughter Courtney, as they mourn her death. Many of you know her, and the funeral is going to be on this coming Friday at St. Teresa's in Perryville. Let us unite our hearts together in prayer. Eternal God, we lift before your throne of grace this day the people that have been identified to us who are desperately in need of our support and prayer and for your healing touch. We pray that you will give all those who are involved as a part of the care for our friends, that you will give them the wisdom they need and the insights that they must have to bring about the healing that we pray for. We pray, Lord, that we know a lot more people who have health challenges, and help us not to forget, but to be reminded again and again that as we support them in prayer, that your healing presence becomes known. We pray, Lord, for our nation. Our hearts are torn apart by the news that we hear every day, whether it has to do with shootings or storms. Many of our friends are filled with fear or anxiety. It's just a part of our society today, Lord, and we pray that you will speak to our hearts and give us the peace that passes all understanding, even in the midst of what we see day by day. We thank you for the gift of your Son, for the peace that passes all understanding, for the privilege that's ours of worshiping you here today. Later this week, when we celebrate All Souls Day and are reminded afresh of the people who've gone before us, who were so much a part of our lives in the past, we thank you for their witness and their presence along our journey. I pray that you will give the comfort that only you can give in the time of remembrance. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege that's ours of being here, for the gift of music and singing and the gift of your holy word. We are so blessed. We ask that you might use this church as a light to those who live around here, to those who live around us, wherever we might be, that we might be a light, the light that we receive from you. Help us to be faithful, that we might give you the honor, the glory, the praise for what you have done for us. Now hear us as we pray together Jesus' prayer, when he taught his disciples, long ago, when he taught his disciples to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Things. Lori, please, children, come up.
Felicia's moving in.
Yes, I'm moving in. Thank you, ma'am.
All right, you can sit with here with me. All right, so I'm going to call Mr. David Swihart over here. He brought some items for me. He's got some goodies that he's going to show us kids today, this morning. All right, so we're going to play this game where I'm going to pull out an object, and you're going to tell me which season of the year it reminds you, okay? So I want everybody to pay attention.
Summer.
Summer, okay.
Winter?
Okay. So we have, for those who can't see it online, it's actually hot chocolate. Who doesn't like hot chocolate? Please tell me you do like hot chocolate. Okay, excellent. And also we have, for those who are watching online, a sombrero who would like, you know, use straw hats during the summer. Okay. And let's see, a couple of things. This one? Winter. So for those watching online, those are mittens. My favorite thing for the winter. Okay, now Mr. David, show us the umbrella, please. No, don't open it, please. That's bad luck. No, it's too uncomfortable. Okay, children, how about this umbrella? What season?
Probably fall.
Fall?
Yeah. Fall.
Spring?
Fall.
What about you?
Spring.
Okay,
perfect. Now the last one, Mr. David, my favorite season, fall. For those watching online, these are nice, beautiful leaves that we see, and it's very nice foliage here in Pittsburgh. Really like that. So for this leaf, what does that mean, kids, when we see fallen leaves? What does that tell you?
Fall.
Uh-huh, but it's going to be fall, but what happens? These leaves are on the ground. Yeah, they're dying. Means a new life coming later on during the spring. And today, children, we're also trying to think that in the Bible, there are passages that talk about there is a season for everything. Like, you know, we saw the season for hot chocolate, you know, the sombrero, the Mr. David's favorite umbrella. So we all have seasons. We have a time to born, but also we have a time that we pass away, and that's all right. That's how life is. And we cry for those who have lost. How many of you had a puppy or a kitty that you remember, that you like? What something do you like about them?
I used to have a dog, but she died.
Okay.
What do you like about her?
Well, one thing that I didn't like about her, I didn't have so she was really old when she was active when I was young, but now that I'm active, she used to be like a slow dog, like I don't want to run a wild dog.
Gotcha.
How about you?
We had a cat named Sweeney. I liked him because he was really fluffy, but we had to give him away because he wasn't good with other cats.
Okay.
How about you, Owen?
I had a cat named Pickles. He was very fluffy.
Okay. What do you like about Pickles?
He was lazy, and we could pet him whenever we wanted.
Okay.
How about you? Yeah, didn't have any pets, but we had someone that we knew before in our lives. And I also want to show you one thing. This is a picture of my grandmother. My grandmother passed away when I was 17, and what I remember about my grandma is that she used to tell me, Felicia, stop eating junk food. Make sure that you have something nutritious with you. So my grandmother was always scolding me, but I remember that about her. But I also remember that my grandma used to make me coffee, but coffee with milk, with bread. It's very, very good, and I remember that about her. So one way that we remember people that we love in our lives is to pictures, if you have a picture of your kitty or a puppy or a grandma or somebody or a friend of yours, to remember them for who they were. And in my country, in Nicaragua, I don't know if you can see the pictures there. Oh, we cannot show them up there? Oh, perfect. This on November 2nd, or actually November 1st, we have, have you all heard of COCO, right? Day of the Dead?
Yeah.
You all about that? Well, we don't have exactly like that, but we have called Day for All Souls and Saints. So a lot of people actually go to the cemeteries, like you see that family over there, they have flowers and they place them on the tombstone of their loved ones to remember them. I think there's another one, Greta. There you go. That is a nice picture of somebody. Actually, those pictures were taken by my father. And it's really nice because it's a way to remember our loved ones. So children, today, this morning, although there are seasons of life, we have hope, but it's also good to remember those who have gone before us, which represents good examples. Mr. David, would you like to end us with prayer?
We are thankful for all the people that have been in our lives, Lord. We especially remember certain times of the year, those that are no longer with us and are with you. And we look forward to seeing them again. This we ask in your son's name. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. David. Now, children, you're dismissed for Children's Church.
The scriptures today are from the book of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 22 through 32. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me!" Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable to God, our rock, our redeemer. Several years ago, I was the pastor at the Wilkinsburg Baptist Church. And there was a woman in that church who was a character. You don't have any of those here, but a tremendous woman of faith, too. And I'll never forget the story she told one time. She said she lived in a high-rise building right in downtown Wilkinsburg. And every once in a while, she would go out to buy some groceries. And on one occasion, she said, "I was carrying my groceries home when all of a sudden I had a pain that kind of shot up my arm, and I could feel it in my back, and I didn't know if I was going to be able to make it home. And she lived alone, and so that was of great concern to her. She said, I prayed right then. I said, Lord, how will I make it home? And then she said, a car pulled up beside me. It was a jitney driver, whom I've used on several occasions. And he said, do you need a ride, Emma Jane? That was her name, Emma Jane. She said, wow, yes, I really do. He said, well, hop in and I'll take you home. And she said, I can't believe it. I said, what do you mean you couldn't believe it? She said, well, I knew that God answers prayer. I just didn't know that he did so fast. And she meant it from her heart. She was sure that God had sent that jitney driver to help her get home. You and I live by faith in today's world, and it's a real challenge. A real challenge, because of so much of what we see around us seems dark. In our text today, we learn about Peter and the disciples, and that they are men of both faith and doubt. Worry, fear, despair were all a part of their life, even though they were with Jesus. I want you to think about this story that was read for us, about the storm, about Jesus, about Peter. Which part of the story speaks to you? Well, I noticed as I read the story, that there were three times when Matthew, the writer, used the word immediately. Immediately, he said. Even in the midst of the storm, Jesus was responding immediately. In their hour of need, Jesus came to them. I thought one of the songs we might sing today was Master, the Tempest is Raging. You know that song? How many of you know that song? Oh, man, you guys got a lot of work to do here, I'll tell you. Wow. You don't know that? Oh, you know, I think about that from time to time. Of all the hymns, songs that I know that minister to my spirit and people just don't know them today.
My grandfather's favorite hymn was that song.
Oh, Master, the Tempest is Raging. Yes. Ah. Yeah. Well, at any rate, where in the story does God speak to you? One of the translations says that it was during the fourth watch of the night. And the fourth watch of the night, that's from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. Ever have a night when you couldn't get to sleep, or you woke up and the time just seemed to drag on because, you know, it's 3:30 a.m., you know, 4:30 a.m., and one woman that I talked to said, it's good to know that Jesus was there even during the fourth watch of the night. Because sometimes that is the loneliest time in my life. In this passage, there are three phrases that the disciples use. And then Jesus responds to them. It says, the description of them says they were terrified. And Jesus says, take courage. take heart. They cried out, "It's a ghost." Jesus said, "It is I." And I'm sure they recognized his voice. And then it says they cried out in fear. And he says, "Have no fear." Interesting. Fear of the unknown. Fear of what's going to happen. Maybe you know someone who has a fear that really isn't based in anything in particular. They just have that fear. My grandson, when he was 8 and 9 and 10, he was afraid of the rain. We never understood why. But 4 or 5 times during dinner, he would get up and go and look out. If he heard that there was going to be a storm coming, he would get up out of his chair and go and look out the window to see if the rain had started yet. It was a fear that he had. And I'm sure you know people who have fears that aren't founded on anything in particular. They just are afraid. Sometimes people are afraid to be alone. Sometimes children won't go to visit other children because they're afraid. They don't know why, they just are. In our story today, the disciples were afraid because they were in the midst of a storm. Anyone ever been in a boat in a storm? Anybody? You have? Okay. The only time I remember being in a boat in a storm was we were in Wales. I was there. I had done a pulpit exchange with a pastor in Wales, and we were taking the boat from Wales to Ireland, and we were down in the bottom of the boat, and we thought, we remembered Poseidon adventure, and if the boat turned upside down, then we would be, if we were in the bottom of the boat would be above the water. You know. Fortunately, nothing happened, but to be in a boat in a storm, you couldn't control anything. Then Peter decides that if it's really Jesus, then Jesus could call to him and have him walk on the water. And Peter tried that, didn't he? But then something happened. He evidently got distracted from the wind and the waves, the billows, the buffeting that went on. And I'm thinking he lost his focus. He got distracted by all that was around him, the turmoil. And in that process, he forgot that Jesus was right in front of him. He was distracted by the waves. That happens to us sometimes, doesn't it? You think you're going to be a person of strong faith, and then something happens and you get distracted. Either something happens that you didn't plan on, or something doesn't happen that you did plan on. We get caught up in the details and we lose our focus and start looking at the surroundings rather than at the one who calls to us, Jesus, remembering his love, his grace, his mercy, knowing we can draw upon his strength. And so we cry out like Peter does, "Lord, save us." And then what happens? It says Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took a hold of Peter's hand. He caught him. The moment when he thought he was going to sink, Jesus was there for him, saved him. God saves those who cry out to him. Are you in the story somewhere? Are you one of the disciples in the boat, worried all the time? Are you Peter, who demonstrates faith, but then easily gets distracted. Or maybe you're someone else in the story. Maybe you are Jesus in the story. Maybe you are the person who is there to help someone else while they are experiencing the storm in their lives. The time when you become a source of hope for someone else. That's pretty neat when that happens. God uses you to catch someone else who is sinking. Sometimes we are the answer to someone else's prayers. How many of you believe that? Anybody? No? Oh, a few of you. Sometimes we are the answer to someone else's prayers. We all find ourselves in different parts of this story during our journey of faith. The challenge is to keep our focus on Jesus, not allow what's going on around us to sidetrack us as we journey in faith. To claim the promises of Jesus and to continue not only to be have Him reach out to us, but through us to reach out to others. We're all in the story. Whether we're in the midst of a storm now or a friend is, these people that we've been praying for, they are in the midst of a storm. And it's important for you and I to become Jesus to them in some sense where we can reach out, maybe a phone call, maybe a card in the mail, certainly through our prayers. Be a source of hope for them. Demonstrating again and again that Jesus really is the Son of God. That's what they said. This is one of two places where it says that the disciples worshiped Jesus. That's what it says. The last verse. They worshiped Him and said, "Truly, He is the Son of God." The other place was when they experienced Him after the resurrection. It says they worshiped Him. Demonstrating again and again. His words to them, take heart. You and I live in a society where things are very discouraging, aren't they? I mean, they are to me. And every night on television, we see it. We know people who have experienced it. Fear is a very big part of many people's lives. Even thinking about sending your child to school, and you become fearful. God, who was our help in ages past, is still our hope today. And we see this again and again throughout the Bible. It's not just here. Let me share with you a couple of texts. Isaiah 41, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God, and I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Isaiah 26, "You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast, because they trust in you." The Psalms are filled with this, fear and hope. "I sought the Lord, and He answered me. He delivered me from all my fears." In John, we read, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid." And then Paul, speaking to the Philippians, "Do not be anxious about anything." Wow, that's a big order, isn't it? I mean, "But in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Remember this. Just because you're in the midst of a storm, it doesn't mean that the storm has to be in you. Right? That's our challenge. That's the hope that we have, that we know that we're not alone in the storm. Let us unite our hearts together in prayer. Eternal God, we do give you thanks this day for this fresh reminder that you are there with us no matter what we face. Whether we find ourselves in the hospital, whether we find ourselves reaching out to help another person, maybe with a meal, with a friendship, with just a point of contact. We need your help every day. Help us to see where you are reaching out and trying to touch our lives. Help us to see where you want us to go and to be and what you want us to say, so that we can be your ambassadors, your children. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
As Jesus said to Peter, "Take heart, do not be afraid," we are called to say, "Take heart, do not be afraid," to those that live on the margins, those in need, and to encourage our missionaries throughout the world. Our offering and dedication to the World Mission Offering is one way to say to the world, "Take heart, do not be afraid." Let us come together in prayer, asking God to bless our World Mission Offering. Lord, as we bring our gifts for the World Mission Offering to you, we pray for our American Baptist missionaries around the world. May our tithes be used for your continued provision to meet our missionaries' needs, the vision you give them, and the relationship they build to bring salvation to those who need your love and hope. May you use our gifts to support those called to preach, teach, and love across all continents. Amen.
Above the heavenly host.
Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord use you this week as an ambassador of his. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.